To all. Today we have an eminent personality, Dr. Chinna Chedian, as a speaker of today's webinar. Sir has completed MSc Nursing in Anna Meenakshi College of Nursing, Coimbatore in 2010 in a specialization of medical surgical nursing, in that a super specialty of oncology of nursing. Sir has completed PhD nursing at Himalayan University in 2020-21. And sir has also published various publications in national and international journals. Sir has also presented various research papers in many conferences. Sir has organized national and international conferences, workshops, seminar, and CNE. And sir is a university examiner of both PG and UG in Tamil Nadu. Sir is also associated with many professional bodies like TNI and other professional bodies. And sir is presently working as a principal at Basumati Institute of Nursing, Tamil Nadu. Now, I welcome you, sir, for this today's webinar on oncology medications and nurses' role. Thank you, sir, and over to you, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Abhay. And thanks for giving me this opportunity to the Parallel University, the team of organizing this webinar, and the Parallel University team members, especially the nursing college members, principal, and everyone. And special thanks to Dr. Sindai, who has contacted me before a couple of days and asked for. Presenting a topic in this webinar. Thanks for Dr. Sindai. I think he is an associate professor over there in Parallel University Nursing Department. And thank you. And let's move on to the webinar. See, my topic is, am I audible to you all? Is it okay now?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So today's topic is on oncology medications and nurses' role. So it's a like oncology, when we talk about oncology, cancer, it is a leading cause of death in the world because we could not able to identify the exact cause. And whenever the exact cause is identified, we can, the world can prepare any medication. So still now we could not able to identify the exact cause for cancer. So the medication is supplementary, that may be life-saving, but the medication still now it has not been found that for a curable of cancer. So we need to understand that cancer is a dreadful disease. Okay? So when we go for introduction, cancer, that is oncology, is the study of cancer. Cancer is the uncontrolled growth of abnormal cells anywhere in a body. It might happen anywhere in a body. There are over 200 types of cancer in the world. Okay, the cancer is the second leading cause of death in the world. How it develops? The cancer develops when the body's normal control mechanism stops working. Normally, our body has some lifespan. The cells have some lifespan, and within the lifespan or after the within the lifespan, it should die and multiply. Die and multiply. This is what the normal mechanism of our cells' stage of growth is. But what happens here is, cancer develops when the body's normal control mechanism stops working, like the old cells do not die and instead grow out of control. The old cells means within a, if it is a RBC, it has its own lifespan. It should die within that life. It should grow, die, do its work, die within the lifespan. And again, after the lifespan, new cell grows. That is what the normal mechanism of growth is. But here, what does it do is, the old cells will not die. Instead, it grows out of control. Out of control, it grows. That is what called as proliferation of cells, rapid growth of cells. So what happens is, the uncontrolled growth, that is uncontrolled, whenever the old cells is not dying, then automatically it becomes an abnormal cell, which is not needed to our body. So these extra cells may form a mass of tissue that is called as tumor. This tumor might be benign or malignant. Benign is non-cancerous. Malignancy is cancerous, and it has a tendency to spread from one part of the body to the other part of the body. So the definition here, it goes like cancer. Cancer refers to an abnormal growth of cells which had the tendency to multiply. That is what malignancy or metastasis. And at any time, even metastasis or transfer from into any from one tumor to another tumor. This tumor can be either benign, or cancerous or malignant in nature. See, there are etiology for any disease conditions. We have some etiologies, but in cancer, we do not know it is the etiology or causes, exact causes. So here it is idiopathic. The causes are idiopathic. So, but there are many risk factors for cancer. That is, a cancer risk factor is anything that increases a person's chance of getting cancer. So at most risk of do not directly causes cancer, but some people with several risk factors never develop cancer. This is also there. Some people will, if they have without risk factor also, they may develop cancer. Some people with more risk factor also, they don't even get a risk of cancer. So either this side also is all there and that is also there. So the risk factors generally known as old age, like the life is getting old. When we get old, that is much a risk factor, because the tendency of fighting against the disease is reduced as the age grows on. A personal or family history of cancer, hereditary, that is what called as hereditary or genetic factor. If the individual has a risk of any previous history of cancer, that is a history of cancer like familial history, like a father, mother, blood related history, though he or she is also under risk of getting cancer. Using of tobacco, chewing tobaccos, it's much chewing tobacco, smoking is a mainly a risk factor, and obesity. Obesity is a risk. It may lead to many diseases, and from those diseases, secondary there is we may affect cancer. And alcoholism is also another risk factor. Some types of viral infections such as HPV, that is human papilloma virus, which is important risk factor of cervical cancer, especially in the females. And some specific chemicals which are used in dye industries, rubber industries, paint industries, and it goes on. Even in fertilizers, what the chemical is being used in the plastic industries, almost all the type of chemicals which are used in the industries, especially the industries or the people who expose indirect to the chemicals in the rubber, tube, plastics, paints, fertilizers, they are the risk of getting this type of any type of cancers. And exposure to radiations, including ultraviolet radiations, even especially the farmers, when we work in the bare body under the direct sunlight, especially between the 11 a.m. to 3 p.m. So direct sunlight may fall on our individual's body. So they are under risk of getting this type of cancers. Okay, see, these are all some of the risk factors of cancers. And when we go for management, there are different type of management. That is chemotherapy, hormonal therapy, immunotherapy, radiation therapy, stem cell therapy, surgery, targeted therapy, and hypothermia. So these are all the few managements which we do for cancer. That is, these are all the management. But when in some other diseases, when we say it is a management, we expect the disease to be cured. But here the management is to make the individuals to go or for a peaceful death. So these are the management that we are trying to extend the life, but not we could not able to cure the patient's disease. That is what the management is. Here the chemotherapy mainly is a drug that treatment that uses powerful chemicals to kill the fast growing cells in our body. Next is hormone therapy. Hormone therapy is a cancer treatment that slows or stops that slows or stops the growth of cancer cells that uses hormones to grow, especially the endocrine hormone. The next is the immunotherapy. It is a type of cancer treatment. It is also a type of cancer treatment that helps the immune system to fight against the cancer. So the radiation therapy, as well as there are different two types of radiation therapies. One is radiotherapy and brachytherapy, which is external therapy and internal therapy. Okay, so here the radiation, high dose of radiations are used to kill the cancer cells. Especially, what does it do is they try to shrink it. If the tumor is in the size of 6 mm, they will give radiation therapy to shrinken the tumor to from the 6 mm to 2 mm or 1 mm. They try to reduce the or shrinken the tumor in size. That is what they are doing, this radiation therapy. Stem cell therapy is also known as regenerative medicine. Okay, promotes the repair and injured tissues using stem cells from a donor. Instead of getting a organ from a donor, here the stem cell is taken from either from the patient as well as from the donor. Only the stem cell is being transplanted, and then with the help of stem cell, they are repairing the injured tissues. And the next is surgery. As we all know, it's there are different types of surgery according to the presence of tumor in the body. So wherever at the site, whichever the site is present, they will be removing the tumor with the surrounding normal tissues to make sure that the cancer is not being spread. Okay, that is what the surgery is. And targeted therapy, here the targeted therapy in the cancer treatment that is used to uses drugs, a type of drugs to target the specific genes and especially the proteins to avoid they will be inhibiting the proteins so that the growth will be avoided or prevented. So the proteins are being involved in the growth of and survival of cancerous cells. So the targeted therapy targets the inhibition of proteins which supplies to the particular tumor, so that protein, if the protein is inhibited, automatically the tumor cannot grow, or the tumor abnormal cells, cancerous cells cannot grow. That is what the main target of the target therapy is. And next one is hypothermia. Hypothermia is a little bit new word in this management. Like hypothermia, what they do is the medical treatment in which the body tissue is exposed to temperature that is between 40 to 45 degrees Celsius, so that the cells will be given more heat, so that the blood supply will be more, and they'll be reducing the growth of tumor. So these are all some of the management, especially chemotherapy, hormone therapy, immunotherapy, radiation therapy, cells, stem cell transplantation, surgery, targeted therapy, and hypothermia. So the next one is management, especially when our topic is regarding the oncology medications and nurses' role. So here we are dealing with our topic, that is chemotherapy. So chemotherapy is also called as a toxin or anaphylactic, is antioplastic therapy, encompasses a group of high-risk hazardous drugs. Here the high-risk drugs are being used, hazardous drugs are being used. So when we deal, when as a nurse, oncological nurse, when you deal with the oncological medications, either it may be in any form, it may be in tablet form, or it may be in injection form, the nurse should be aware of preventing herself as well as the patient, because it is a hazardous medications, or it is a hazardous drugs. So what does it do is the chemical, that is chemotherapy, do is it intend to destroy as many cancer cells within the minimal effect on the healthy cells of as possible. That is what it tries to destroy the cells, cancerous cells, okay, with minimal effect. Anyway, almost all the treatments in chemotherapy has it has their own side effects according to their own there is chemotherapy, it has another nausea, vomiting, alopecia, like this radiation also has this nausea, vomiting, alopecia as a side effects or complications. But the nurses, the oncological nurse, should be aware and educate the patients. And this is what the chemotherapy is been the father of chemotherapy is Paul N. Ehrlich. He coined the term as chemotherapy in the year of 1908. And Sidney Faber, the father of modern chemotherapy, he introduced use of antifolates. Okay, the management here, the chemotherapy is goes like this. The era of cancer therapy began in the year of 1940s with the first use of nitrogen mustards and folic acid antagonist drugs. So here there are different classical drugs. It is used in different modalities like neoadjuvant chemotherapy, adjuvant chemotherapy, palliative chemotherapy, chemo prevention, and concurrent therapy. What does it this neoadjuvant do is neoadjuvant chemotherapy is the therapy is a chemotherapy chemo there is combination of chemical drugs for cancer drugs is being given before surgery to shrinken or to reduce or to minimize or to destroy or to control the cancerous cells. Okay, and adjuvant therapy is given, this type of medication, the chemotherapy medication is given after the surgery. Once after the surgery, the removal of tumor with the surrounding part, once they are given, neoadjuvant is given to reduce, it might be a reducing the size like a radiation therapy. And after this neoadjuvant therapy, they may also go for this surgery. Okay, and after surgery, they may go for this adjuvant chemotherapy because we need to strictly notice that from the surgical part also there should not be any growth of tumor. So it's a combination of therapy. These surgery, cancer, there is a cancer surgery, and chemotherapy and radiation therapy, addition with all other therapies, or a combination of therapies which helps to reduce and destroy the growth of tumors. That is what the main aim of the cancerous treatment is. Next is palliative chemotherapy. It aims to relieve or delay the cancer symptoms. Palliative at the end stage. Palliative means the end stage of life, end stage of cancer people's life. So focusing on comfort. Here the palliative mainly focuses on the comfort, relieving of pain, symptomatic management, and improve quality of life or the given for metastatic disease. That is to reduce the pain, especially to reduce the pain and focus on the patient's comfort is the palliative chemotherapy. And chemo prevention, here the chemo prevention is given to the high risk persons to prevent cancer with selected pharmaceutical agents, like to prevent if the patient has been identified as a high risk group, cancer high risk patient or individual, then the chemo prevention is given with a combination of chemical drugs. And concurrent therapy with there is radiation therapy and immunotherapy, the combination of radiation and immunotherapy called as concurrent therapy. So these are all the some of the chemotherapy modalities of chemotherapy which has been given before and after surgery and combination of other treatments. Chemotherapy drugs, mainly the classification of antineoplastic drugs is being divided into chemical structure and resource of the drug. And the next is cell cycles, from the cell cycle or phase of specifically of the drugs. So from these are the subdivision, and from there is again divided into, there is a chemical structure and the resource of drug divides into cytotoxic drugs, hormones and hormone agent antagonists, and immunomodulators. And here the cell cycle or phase specific of drugs divides into two, that is cell cycle non-specific agents and cell cycle specific agents. So this is all the some of the division of classification of chemo drugs. And now what we do is the nurses, The nurse's main responsibility for administering IV chemotherapy. So IV or oral chemotherapy, the nurses needs to be aware, because when it is, first thing is the chemotherapy drugs are more costly, and it is a risk of getting the tablets or the medications or injections, any form. It is costly, as well as it is hard to get it also. And second thing is, it is harmful. Harmful means it may harm the normal individuals. Normal, if the chemical is being spilled, if the injection has been spilled into the nurse's body, any part of the body, the skin may cause some negative reactions or any other skin reactions, especially if the injection is in the chemotherapeutic injection has been spilled over the nurse's body or a skin which is exposed, then there might be alopecia, especially the hair loss. So there are some different types of reactions. So the nurse, oncological nurse, who is preparing to administer a chemical, that is oncology chemotherapy or oncological drugs, should be very, very preventive, as well as he or she should be aware of harmfulness towards herself and to the patients. So here, the prior to administration, what all they do is, as usual, the patient the nurse should assess the patient, confirm allergies, and evaluate any pre-existing symptoms in the patient, and verify signed consent for the treatment, which should be obtained and signed by the provider as well as the patient. Monitor the laboratory values and verify laboratory values within acceptable range for dosing. And take measures to prevent medication errors. We know there are different rights of medication. So follow the rights of medications and perform independent double check of original orders with the second registered nurse. The doctor's order should be double checked before administering any type of chemotherapeutic drugs to the patient. The patient should also be the right patient should be there, right dose should be there. That's what follow the rights of the medications. And double check for the accuracy of treatment regimen, chemotherapy agent, dose, calculation of the body surface area, schedule, and route of administration. We should check or double check these things and recalculate chemotherapy dose independently for accuracy. Next is verify appropriate pre-medication and pre-hydration orders. Ensure patient education completed and address outstanding patients' questions. We should educate the patient prior to the chemotherapy drug administration, as well as we need to clarify the doubts of the patient as well as the family before administering the drugs. That is what our nurse's responsibility before administering a drug. And during administering the drug, chemotherapy drug, to a patient, what all the responsibility of nurses? There is nurse verification and sign off at the bedside. Dual nurse should sign. Compare original order to dispense drugs label at the bedside with another, that is dual nurse should verify the patient identity and then the drug, and before administration and also during the administration. Safe handling of hazardous medication reduces exposure to self and others, especially, that is what I'm from the beginning I'm saying, it's a hazardous medication, so we need to be safe and we need to be prevent ourselves and the patient. And intravenous line management, that is it should be checked, the insertion that should be evaluated and it should be assessed before IV chemotherapy. And continuous patient monitoring for acute or adverse drug effect and allergic reactions. Prompt recognition and management of hypersensitivity reaction should be noted. Safe handling and management of chemotherapy spills should be avoided. That is what main target is. There is safe handling avoids spills. And after administration of this IV chemotherapeutic drugs, flush IV line, ensure brisk blood return prior to removing peripheral IV devices, flush or maintain vascular access device according to the institution policy. Safe handling and disposal of hazardous waste according to the institution policy, because this IV fluid, IV line, or the used IV line, or a used IV chemotherapy IV injection material, IV articles should not be mixed with the normal waste, that is waste products. It should be discarded, or it should be put in a safe dustbin, so that will not mix with the other thing. And this disposable method is totally different than the other disposables. And document is in medical record and the medications given. Patient education and patient response, including any adverse effects. So documentation is necessary. The documentation of the what the medication is given. Patient education should be documented, and the patient response should be documented, including any other adverse reactions if you find during, before, and after administering of IV chemotherapy drugs. Ensure the patient has appropriate discharge instructions. If the patient is advised to discharge, then you need to go for appropriate instructions, and we need to check whether there is anti-nauseic medications, because nausea is sort of a common side effect of chemotherapy. And you need to educate the patient to contact the doctor immediately wherever there is a chance of emergency. Okay, so these are some of the responsibilities of an oncological nurse prior to IV administration of chemotherapy, during administration of chemotherapy IV drugs, and after administration of IV drugs chemotherapy. And the next is nurse's responsibility of administering oral chemotherapy. Here the general safety guidelines, what we do is, there is keep cancer drugs in original packing until used or placed within the daily pill box. Until and unless it is needed, please do not open. The nurse should not open, as well as she should advise the patient and the family relatives not to open the medication from the pills, that is pack, original packing. And do not mix the chemotherapy medication with other medications in the pill box. So chemotherapy medications should be differently kept differently, and the other medications, if the patient is getting other type of medication, that should be kept differently. Okay, they should always remain separate from the other medications. Perform hand hygiene with soap and water, hand wash with soap and water before and after handling of all medication. This is a common responsibility of a nurse. Do not let the medications come in contact with household surfaces, especially the counter tops and tables. If it has been contaminated, if it have a contact with the normal house surfaces, then clean the surface thoroughly to remove all the trace of the drugs. Store the medication in a cool, dry, and away from the excess heat or sunlight. This is much necessary. So these are some of the general guidelines. Next is safe medication disposal. Never discard cancer medications in household trash. There also in IV, even IV chemotherapy also, we have noted that it should be safely discarded. Here also, they are saying that never discard the cancer medications in the household trash. Place down the drain or flush down into the toilet. Instruct the client to ask the drug distributor or pharmacist where to return unused and unleft over medications. See, that should not be kept aside. That should not be put aside, because it is not a common drug. It is a chemotherapy, chemical hazardous drug. So where you have got the medications, give it to them or ask them where to return it or where to dispose it or to whom should be returned it. Empty pill bottles may be put in household trash. Do not recycle it. Normally, if it is, if not, not normally, some in some houses or some in places, what they do is they will use the reuse the bottles, especially if you get a cup syrup, if it is completed, then they'll be trying to reuse it, but not like this. We need not to reuse the empty pill bottles of chemotherapy. Okay, it is harmful. So never reuse cancer medication pill bottles also. Not only the empty bottles, no bottle should be reused. And exposure to household contacts, like whenever when the possible, the patient should handle their medication themselves. The patient is able to handle the medications and handle them, advise them to handle themselves, not to give to their family members or other things. If anyone other than the patient comes in contact with the cancer pills, advise them to wash the affected area or wash the handled area with soap and water immediately. If the rash, skin rashes and something occurs on for the third individual, then advise them to go for the contact the doctor or go for physician for that, so that they will be having some treatment. Caregiver should transfer the medications into a cup or spoon when handling the medications, not in a direct hand. If at all they need to pick, either if there is a situation, unavoidable situation to pick the tablet by hands, then wear gloves. If you wear double gloves also, that is much good. So try to avoid touching the medications. If there is a chance of touching or if there is a situation to touch the medication, wear gloves to touch the medications. Then next is, if there is any contact with body fluids, especially the saliva, urine and other body fluids, then household trash should not be double, that is, it should be double packed. Before disposing, it should be double packed. Gloves should never be reused. Once you use the gloves for medication, it should not be used again. So it should not be reused. That is, never reuse it and discard the gloves in household trash after once it is been used. So this is what about the household contacts. And the next is household. A small amount of medications may be present in the patient's urine, stool, vomits or blood. So what we need to do is caregivers should wear disposable gloves when handling the body fluids. If the house caregivers need to give a tablet, touch the tablet wearing the gloves. If the patient could, the caregivers could have the situation to handle the patient's urine, stools or vomits and bloods, use gloves. And item solids soiled with body fluids should be kept in plastic bags until washed. And then these items should be washed separately from the other laundry in hot water. There is patient's materials, patient's clothes, patient's using any material should be washed, cleaned separately. That should not be mixed with the other individuals, other home, family members' property. And pregnant women should not come in contact with the medications or body fluids. It is strictly said that pregnant women should not come in contact. And low pressure toilet should be double flushed after each use of patients on oral cancer medications. What does it do is the toilet lid should be always closed prior to flushing. If any fluid splashes from out of the toilets, then clean it with disinfectant cleaner, wearing gloves or with other cleaning materials, and take precautions to ensure pets do not lick or drink the toilet, that is the fluids. So these are about the, still now we have seen about the responsibility of a nurse, oncological nurse. Now the role of oncological nurse. There are different roles of oncological nurses. There is one is direct care provider, patient assessment, care team member, patient educator, care coordinator, supportive care provider, patient advocate, liaison officer, teacher, researcher, counselor, and a friend. So these are some of the roles as an oncological nurse act towards the patient on there is cancer patients. So let's see one by one. So direct care provider. Oncological nurse provide direct care, including chemotherapy. Nurses involved in the direct delivery of chemotherapy is to ensure that the correct dose and drug are administered by the correct route to the right point patient. So direct care provider ensures the nurse should ensure that the right dose is provided by the right order to the right patient in the right manner or right way. Okay. The next is patient assessment. Here the patient, that is the oncological nurse, is going to assess the patient previous, present history, especially his health history or surgical history and health practices, and even the family's knowledge on the disease and its treatment. Everything, almost totally the patient, that is the nurse, assess the patient, both physical, psychological, as well as the family assessment, so that it will be helpful in the treatment process. And the next is care team member. Care team member, here the patient is the oncological nurses are a part of oncological nurses is a part of interprofessional team. Like here the professional, that is the oncological nurse act as a professional body representing the nurses and with the other team member, interpersonal team members like doctors, radiologists, and lab technicians and other people. So there are the team members work with patients and families to provide integrated care. The patient educator, here the nurse is going to educate the patient. The patient is going to get advices, clear the questions from the nurse. Family members are going to clear their doubts, get some advices from the nurse. So here the patient is the main educator to the nurses are the main educator to the patient and the family. The patient and the family education starts before the therapy and continues during the therapy also, and after the therapy also, when they are even discharged also, the nurse act as a educator. Appropriate written and visual teaching aids may be used, as well as referrals to other professional and community programs such as cancer supports groups. So here with the appropriate AVH technology, then the nurse is going to teach the family and the patients. Such education helps the client to assist with coping their diagnosis, long-term adjustments and symptoms, and to gain information about prevention, diagnosis and care, and to develop skills, knowledge and attitudes to maintain or regain health status. So such education, or as a nurse, as a health educator, she or he can assess the patient, as well as she or he can give important knowledge regarding the treatment, regarding the disease condition, regarding the financial crisis, regarding the coping situation, to regain their health. The patient needs to regain their health. The patient needs to reform their financial status. So patient educator, nurse's main role is patient educator. Next is care coordinator. The oncological nurse plays a vital role in coordinating the multiple and complex technologies now commonly employed in cancer diagnosis and treatment. This coordination emphasizes direct patient care, documentation in medical record, participation in therapy, symptom management, organizing and reference to the other health providers, both patient and family education, as well as counseling throughout diagnosis, therapy, and the follow-up care. So here also, the nurse acts as a coordinator and supportive care provider. Oncology nurses are closely involved with numerous supportive care issues encountered by the cancer patients and their families. The nurses should involve themselves in pain management, especially the pain management and in survivorship of the patient. It is of almost important that the nurse be knowledgeable about the pain assessment and both pharmacological and non-pharmacological management of pain in order to provide good pain control. The supportive care mainly involves or mainly delegates the pain management, because the nurse need to assess the patient's pain. As per the pain, the nurse needs to give treatment either in the pharmacological or non-pharmacological manner to reduce the pain and provide comfort to the patients. And the next one is liaison official. The nurses, oncological nurse, maintain a close points of contact between client and the hospital administration, physician, and other staff members. Here, the liaison nurse will create clear lines of communication between the various parties. So the oncological nurse act as a bridge between the patient and other team members, especially the management or hospital management, patient, other staff members. So as care related decisions are made, the oncological nurse translate the patient's perspective to other interpersonal interactive members, and vice versa. She act as a bridge between the patient as well as the other members. A liaison officer, the nurse has the rights to investigate delays in treatment and effectively resolves any patient's issues or despites, and to create a safe and comfortable environment for the patients and staffs. And patient advocate, here also the nurses training in nurse-patient relationship emphasize the importance of patients' perspectives, values, and preference. As a patient's advocate, the oncological nurse arranges a meeting between the doctor and the patient's family when the patient was too ill to participate. If the patient could not able to participate with the meeting of doctor, and here the nurse advocate, acting as an advocate between the doctors and the family to plan the next treatment of the ill patient. Okay, next, the teacher. As oncological nurse, he or she should be expert in explaining cancer and the cancer treatments. They help the patient and their family to understand the disease, completely about the disease, and explain the treatment process. Oncological nurse use their clinical knowledge and technical expertise to ensure that the patient understands what is happening with their body in every stage of treatment. So the teacher, as we discussed previously, the nurse act as a educator, teacher, to explain what is the cancer, what happens within the body, what happens even after treatment or during treatment or priority treatment. This should be told and explained to the patient and the family clear. And the counselor, in addition to addressing the physical needs of their patients, oncological nurse care for their patient's emotional well-being. The oncological nurse help the client to recognize and cope with stressful psychological or social problems, and are able to connect patient to a resource outside the hospital that can help with the mental, financial, and family related stress that comes along with the cancer disease. So counselor, here the nurse, oncological nurse, explains or stay with the helps the patients with the emotional status, financial crisis, and the family related issues or stress to cope up with the present and future situations. Next is the nurse as a researcher. Oncology nurse often used to research to improve the client's care. Mainly to the nurse goes as a researcher, an oncology researcher, to because the nurse knows assessment, she knows assess cancer, how to assess. So she will assess the patient, what happens to the patient, what may happen to the patient, what is happening to the patient during the disease, and what the treatment will do to the patient, and how the treatment, what type of treatment will help the patient to relieve the signs and symptoms, especially the complications, and especially the disease conditions, especially the tumor. So she, as a researcher, can try to solve many problems with the patients, especially in the treatment as well as the post-treatment complications. And at last, nurse, oncology nurse as a friend to a cancer patients. That oncology nurse and the patient develops a close relationship. They celebrate milestones, birthdays, and holidays together, because when the doctor and other health team workers are away from the patient, the nurses are there, especially the oncology nurses are there with the patient throughout their hospital stay, and even with their home stay, some few nurses. They celebrate their important days. And the nurses from the form an attachment to their parent, that is patients and their family members, that cannot be described. It cannot be described more other than the name of friendship. As a friend to the oncological nurse provide emotional and social support to the client and their family members to cope up with the stress and financial situations, and to bring back, to regain their stressful life. And even the nurses are there to promote comfort, especially to the in the pain management system. And here the nurse or all over a friend, a contributor, an advocate, a researcher, a health educator, a teacher, and overall the nurse is a friend to the cancer patient. So this is all about my topic. Thank you.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. It was a very informative session about oncology medication and role of nurse. So you have explained very well about chemotherapy, what is the role of nurse, especially in chemotherapy. And I'm very thankful to you, sir, for accepting our invitation. And also thank you on behalf of Principal Dr. Ravindra Achan, Principal Parle Institute of Nursing, given me opportunity to conduct this webinar. And also I'm thank you to all the participants. I hope you have this webinar become more fruitful.
Yeah.
And about oncology. And thank you so much, sir.
Thank you for arranging me this wonderful event. And I would like to thank especially to the management organizer and Principal Dr. Ravindra sir and Dr. Sinde. Thank you so much. Thank you, especially special thanks to Abhay. Thank you, Abhay.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Yes, thank you. Bye-bye. Thank you.
Bye-bye. Yeah.